Electrical axis can be calculated for the P wave, QRS complex, T wave, and even the ST segment. But when we mention axis deviation, it is usually the mean electrical axis of the QRS complex. For calculation of mean axis of the QRS complex, the amplitude of the negative waves is subtracted from that of the positive waves while plotting on the graph using lead 1 as x-axis and AVF as y-axis. Another method is to check the lead in which transition from positive to negative QRS occurs using the hexaxial reference system. The axis is perpendicular to the lead in which equiphasic complexes are seen. Calculation of axis using lead 1 and AVF. The axis of lead 1 is taken as 0 towards the left and plus minus 180 degrees towards the right, negative pole of lead 1. The axis of AVF is taken as 90 degrees downwards and minus 90 degrees in the vertically opposite direction. Mean QRS amplitude of lead 1 and AVF are plotted along the corresponding axis and the resultant taken as the mean QRS axis. Calculation of axis using the hexaxial reference system. In the hexaxial reference system, each lead is assigned an axis for its positive pole. The negative pole will be diametrically opposite to it. Hexaxial reference system. The positive poles of the leads are marked by the arrows. Mean QRS amplitude in each lead is checked to see if there is a lead in which it is equiphasic. If so, the QRS axis is taken as perpendicular to it. For example, if the equiphasic complexes are found in lead 1, QRS axis is 90 degrees. It will be plus 90 degrees if AVF is positive and minus 90 degrees if AVF is negative. In this case, AVF will show the longest QRS complex as the QRS axis is along this lead. If no lead is seen as equiphasic, leads in between which the QRS transitions from predominantly positive to predominantly negative is checked. Suppose it is between lead 2 and AVF, then the transition is at plus 75 degrees. QRS axis will be minus 15 degrees if lead 1 is positive and plus 165 degrees if lead 1 is negative. Normal QRS axis is in the right lower quadrant between lead 1 and AVF. If the axis is in the left upper quadrant between lead 1 and AVF, it is taken as left axis deviation. QRS axis up to minus 30 degrees is taken as minor left axis deviation or leftward axis. QRS axis in the right lower quadrant between AVF and lead 1 is right axis deviation. Axis in the right upper quadrant is indeterminate axis, sometimes called northwest axis. It could occur both in extreme right axis deviation and extreme left axis deviation. At a glance, if both AVF and lead 1 are positive, the QRS axis is normal. If lead 1 is negative and AVF is positive, it is right axis deviation. In left axis deviation, lead 1 is positive and AVF is negative. If both lead 1 and AVF are negative, it is indeterminate or northwest axis. ECG showing normal QRS axis. Both lead 1 and AVF are positive. ECG showing northwest or right upper quadrant axis. Both lead 1 and AVF are negative. This ECG shows right bundle branch block and sinus tachycardia in addition. ECG showing right axis deviation. In addition, there is right bundle branch block with very wide QRS and ectopic atrial tachycardia with 2:1 conduction. Another ECG with right axis deviation. QRS in lead 1 is negative and that in AVF is positive. ECG showing left axis deviation with positive QRS in lead 1 and negative QRS in AVF. In addition, there is left bundle branch block. QRS vector can be assessed in multiple planes, horizontal, sagittal, and frontal. The discussion so far has been about frontal plane QRS axis, which is commonly used. T-wave vector can also be assessed. The relation between the T-wave vector and the QRS vector is termed the ventricular gradient. Similar to QRS axis, P-wave axis and T wave axis can also be calculated, but is not routinely done. In modern day computerized electrocardiographs, printing ECG on a full sheet, automatic graphical display of P, QRS and T wave axis is common. The measured values will indicate the exact values computed by the program. Deviations in QRS axis is routinely used for diagnostic purposes, though P and T wave axis are seldom used. Left axis deviation without any other cause is a feature of left anterior hemi block. Right axis deviation without any other causes is taken as a feature of left posterior hemi block, which is much rarer than left anterior hemi block. QRS axis deviation can occur in ventricular hypertrophy. Right axis deviation is one of the features of right ventricular hypertrophy. Please don't forget to subscribe to this channel for future updates and click on the bell icon for all updates. Thank you.